Eko Gokedi is the Deputy Secretary General or General Secretary of the FAU, which is the Food and Allied Workers Union.
Good morning. Amandla. Amandla. Viva, FAU, viva.
Viva.
Viva, COSATU, viva.
Viva.
Since I come here, I'm not convinced to shout this. You're not giving me confidence to go on and on with this Amandla and the viva. So I don't want to feel like I'm addressing a business meeting. But thanks, Chair. I want to talk briefly, and I hope I will be brief, but quite a bit factual, and hopefully I'll be able to represent a fair view of what FAU has actually looked at so far as agricultural workers are concerned. Briefly, under introduction, FAU organized workers who are predominantly in the agricultural sector, your crops, citrus, fruit, grapes, livestock, and plantation and processing, which is the forestry, of course, processing and plantation thereof, sugar, tea, and tobacco, within the fishing in and offshore, and processing part thereof, food manufacturing and beverage processing, sales and distribution, and other related and allied sectors. We are an affiliate of COSAT, of course, the international level affiliate to IUF. We've got a membership of about 127,000. That zero makes a huge difference, eh? Yeah. It's potential membership. It is indeed potential members. Of the 127,000, we have about 31,000 thereof as farm workers. We believe that we have gathered considerable experience and knowledge in the on the sector concerned, which is the agricultural sector and the plight of workers. We have partnered with a number of progressive organizations on strategic issues and cooperated with institutions that focus on the plight of farm workers. We have dedicated a number of resources to address the plight of workers and dwellers. By the way, you would find the presentation talking to both workers and, in some instances, dwellers. Dwellers are either as a result of them having lost the right to occupy or reside by a farm and, in a sense, have them dwelling in certain areas. But there have been a number of definitions of these dwellers, so to say. So I wouldn't be much technical about the issue. Some statistical information that has been at our disposal is that there is between 650 to 850,000 estimated farm workers, which include your fishing, forestry, sugar plantation workers. There are 30,000 to 40,000 commercial farmers, predominantly white commercial farmers, I must say. There are about 300 to 400 smallholding farmers, about 4 million households who practice subsistence agricultural activities. 3 to 4 million living in the commercial farms. About 930,000 evicted from farms during that period. This might be a bit outdated figure, but that's the one I could get at the time of preparing this presentation. We look at the situation thereof. We go as far back as 2003, but it's important that we will also reflect on the post 94 to date situation where one can possibly find it fit. During 2003-2008, the Human Rights Commission have documented some of the same abuses that one will be talking to in this particular presentation. Some civic society have campaigned regarding the South African product that has led to some private sector efforts to improve farm conditions. In acknowledgement of this exploitative situation, Western Cape in particular, agricultural sector has set itself standards and industrial codes of conduct. Some of them are global or international codes of conduct, so to say. And I've already talked to them that are mostly imposed by global or international retailers. By the way, South African government and international law is obliged to respect, protect, and fulfill human rights, and such are ratified international conventions. We talked to the 2010-2011 Human Rights Watch, which I think was very well timed, because what is happening at the Western Cape, so far as one is concerned, is the result of the flagrant denial of what the Human Rights Watch had raised during that period in question. We have looked at the report that was released by Naledi. during this year that dealt with, of course, obstacles regarding organizing farm workers. Generally, the problems that farm workers are confronting and dealers are confronting, we believe that are known. We characterize them mainly as civil, political, living conditions, social service related, and labor rights and working condition related matters. So we'll expand on those topics. So far as we are concerned on political, civil and political issues, we believe there is a question of power relations. The farm is owned by a farmer, simply put. And then you will find situations where there are widespread violation of rights by farm owners. In some instances, workers farm suffer beatings and insult on a regular basis. In some cases, brutal killings. The unfortunate low rate of abuse reporting by farm workers, obviously for fear of victimization in certain instances, poor investigation, if any, has been reported, that leads to... is this sabotage? Oh, okay. No, she's helping me. Thank you very much. It's not sabotage, colleagues. I was making the point that in instances where such abuses have been reported, we find that there is poor investigation on the part of police. Where investigations have taken place, you will realize that you will have low rate of prosecution, and if indeed there is any prosecution, that results in light or suspended sentence on appeal. I want to be reminded of a case where a particular farmer who have violated a farm worker or dweller have really served the sentence. Which one? The one recently in Holobesdar was released, killed a poor young boy. No. The one in Limpopo who fed the land. He paid a certain ransom. No, you'll remind me. Violators of this right are not brought to book, simply put. We looked at living conditions. The essence of the matter is that farm workers and their families generally dwell on farms. Thus, they live in conditions of indignity and slavery circumstances. We believe that they are living even under comparatively worse situation than animals. They hardly have access to social services and even asymmetry. Just at least that, we believe in literally symmetry. It would have been better with respect if we were believing in cremation. Probably there would not have been an issue. That's more on a lighter note. I'm sorry about that. Farm workers and dwellers do not have access to affordable electricity, safe water, shelter and food. In reaction to new laws and policies, we have seen evictions increasing. Living workers and dwellers surviving by the roadside without facilities such as shelter, safe water and ablution or other toilet facilities. Recently, evictions are also as a result of workers organizing themselves for protection against slave type living and living conditions. We continued a bit in terms of some of the issues that we have raised with regard to living conditions. We have in number of forums submitted the need to establish a rural or agricultural residential settlements. There have been a number of debates about the topic itself, where workers and dwellers, we believe, will have access to decent shelter that connects to bulk infrastructure, your safe running water, electricity and ablution facilities, safe public transport, amenities like your funeral and recreation facilities. Their ultimate hopes unfortunately rest in government subsidy and questionnaire land availability. It is difficult to talk to this issue without raising the question of land. Services, access to basic social services. Of course, we re-emphasize the point that farm workers and their families reside on a farm, and therefore they hardly access social services. Their primary constraint is government rollout of social services as farms are private properties. Community workers themselves struggle to reach inside farm to assist workers with accessing social grants and services such as your ID, your application for birth registration certificate and so on and so forth. Farm workers and dwellers are unable to equitably get access to quality education because in some instances school fees, the distance they often travel to and from schools, and sometimes as a result of a school that is within the very same private property. Now the question of education is a very thorny issue so far as we are concerned, because it then revived that endless cycle, that dependency on a farmer. By the way, a farmer is a farm on its own. You will have your piece here, its cemetery, your field here where you work, your peck shed, which becomes a school, a church. You have the farmhouse, and where the farm workers reside, you will have a farm store in that very same area. So the life of a farm worker would be, in a way, within the four corners of that farm. The sooner we do something at the private property, the better. And we're raising that deliberately, the question of land. There is a section in the Act, being the Constitution, that talks to expropriation. Let me continue with the presentation. Let's talk to labor rights and working conditions. Farm workers in the agricultural and forestry sector are considered vulnerable, and we believe that this is worldwide phenomenon, and work under hazardous conditions. Women and children are the most vulnerable and exploited, we argue, and I think one of the presentations yesterday was talking to the issue of women in particular. There will be little to be said about people with disability who may or are not necessarily found if they are in this sector. Employment and exploitation of illegal foreign national. Visually, this is what we are submitting. Farm owners don't have respect to the law and the spirit of the law. To further advance the point, we're saying that they don't provide workers with protective personal clothing equipment or any equipment as per the Occupational Health and Safety Act. They do not comply with transformative and redress laws such as your Employment Equity and your Skills Development Act. They continue to harass, victimize, intimidate, in some instances dismiss workers for belonging to trade union. Some pay less than what their determination is actually stipulating. And this is the current thorny issue at the Western Cape. Mind you, we're not necessarily saying the minimum that is prescribed within the certain determination is fair and in a sense is just and equitable. It is not. Now, when that particular minimum itself, it is not paid for, you are putting a worker in a very worse situation than at least if you were to pay the minimum stipulated in the sector determination. And they generally work long hours without paid overtime. I think it is the point that one must advance the job or task payment based system. Because there's been advancement by employers, particularly farmers, to say there are instances where farm workers will earn more than the determination. It is in situation whereby they impose the job or your task based pay system, simply having a worker to start early, knock off late, without taking meal breaks, and as a result thereof pushing his or her little that she may make out of that allocated task on a particular day. And this is visually seen during your harvesting or other seasonal times. I've reflected the rate, the 771 and the 1503. By the way, this comes from a 650 in 2002, if I'm not mistaken, 2001, 2000. You can imagine. The first determination at 600 was below the government stipulated old age grant. Now I'm an active young worker or even an old worker, and here you have an elderly citizen who by age may not necessarily work, and government is therefore then paying a social grant to such an individual, and you have a person who's working earning at that time lower than an old grant earner. I mean, that was a bit an absurd situation. Fine, we have moved thus far. The 1,500 that is paid for, I think it was as a result of us last year, if not, when we were saying nothing should be promulgated or rather passed by the minister, which would not have been lesser than this. 1,500 was demanded by FAO 2004, if not 5, at that time. You can imagine the time that has lapsed up to now. It's only now that workers are earning this 1,500. It has lost its value. And it does not serve any purpose. I don't want to argue, but these are some of the reasons why I think we have persuaded the Ministry of Labour to look into the current rate of set determination. The claim of private property rights that continues to threaten union officials by employers, of course, by trespassing laws when they organize farm workers. So the other critical obstacle of organizing farm workers into a trade union is the fact that access to farms is an issue. We may not probably have taken advantage of technological invention. Well, farm workers may not afford, some may not.
But that's the debate that I think we must also take as the union to see how best we can rather take the... I'm told I've got 5 minutes and it's starting to count from now. Therefore, I've talked to the question of poor collective bargaining arrangement that therefore denies workers the opportunity to improve their working conditions. Some possible solutions that we have raised with regard to the question of civil and political rights. We have advanced that there should be investment in land, particularly in infrastructure and services where farm workers and dwellers reside. We have, of course, are instigating the need for the amendment of this clause for purposes of transformation in this particular country. We are raising question of strategic and stakeholder engagement. Of course, we are saying there should be standing periodic and topical engagement with stakeholders that are organized in this particular sector, and inclusive planning and strategizing sessions, itemize listing of programmatic priorities, collaboration between the Department of Labor, of Justice, the Police Commissioner. We should include the Department of Agriculture and Forestry because it has been instrumental insofar as this work is concerned. We looked at some of the practical programmatic oversight that we believe the department could do insofar as this thing, the implementation of labor laws is concerned, that the proactive approach should be adopted with regard to the provincial or sector-based or national oversight program, that there must be an increased transparency with regard to information that should be shared in that particular sector. Mind you, there is a question of profit and an income question that, or a wage question that is normally debated. Is it really fair for a, for, I mean, I'm sorry, my 5 minutes start to count now. The proportion of a dollar foreign-based exchange profit, you know, based arrangement and a rand worker earning. Simply put, there is no reason why the Western Capetonian farmers can't pay more, or any other farmer can't pay more, moreover those who are involved in export, taking advantage of that currency rate. But it's fine, I don't want to waste my 5 minutes. We've talked to the role that the Department of Labor can play. We've talked to the role of labor reform. We need to meet with speed so far as this sector is concerned. We have talked to the issue of the 2010 Farm Workers Summit. This was a very important summit. We thought we would move from here and we'll realize change. Unfortunately, we have not realized change simply because of lack of implementation thereof. I know the last bullet might be a wish. We just hope it will become a reality that trade unions and farmers association create that platform where we can literally engage. But one thing that I think we should do, the organized agriculture should be given an award really for walking out on us number of times. You know, normally we'll threaten to walk out, but it is different in the agricultural sector. You will have farmers literally walking out. So we just hope that will help. I think the question of enforcement, advocacy and inspection of labor legislation in this sector is ideal. Aggressive implementation of the minimum standard that are set in the determination. Attention to the transformative legislation, criminalization of labor law violation and infringement of workers' rights. This is very important, the last point, and we're advancing this question. Because workers' rights are also human rights. So they should be arrested. Yeah, they must be arrested. A sad situation at the Durance. A farmer who shot at workers, arrested, released on bail. A worker who is arrested for public violence is arrested and denied bail. Mm-hmm. Well, it's fine. No, it's not. Ethical trade and initiative and code of conduct, we've talked to this issue. We're saying we need to support and play active role and pronouncement on this ethical trade in there. They are self-imposed, number one, but it's important for their market. It's very important that such is supported. And that cut in various sectors, including the wine industry. We must promote and, of course, agitate for codes of conduct for transformative programs that will benefit workers. Thank you very much. I was left with 3 minutes, I know.